And so this is joint work with Rajiv Alur, Joe Devieti, and Umar Navarro Leia. So GPUs are emerging as an important compute platform. They are high throughput, they are scalable, and then with large amounts of data being produced and consumed, they are well positioned to process all this data. However, there is a problem, that is, writing efficient GPU code is hard. So often, writing efficient GPU code involves expert knowledge of GPUs, and this is often inaccessible to regular programmers. And there is very little tool support to help regular programmers write efficient GPU code. So this work is essentially about one such tool. So GPUDrano is a tool that detects uncoalesced accesses in GPU programs. Uncoalesced access is a performance bug, and it's a well-documented issue. It's a well-documented issue in GPU community, but there is very little tool support to identify such accesses. And GPUDrano is a lightweight compile time static analysis to detect such bugs. So let's first understand the GPU programming model and the problem of uncoalesced accesses, and then we'll look into the analysis and how it works. So GPUs follow a single instruction multiple threads model, wherein a large number of threads execute a sequential program. The sequential program has a special variable TID that represents the thread ID of the threads that are executing the program and is used to distinguish the execution of different threads. Further, the program consists of two kinds of variables, local and global variables. Local variables are private to each thread, whereas global variables are shared across threads. Finally, the threads are subdivided into groups of 32 threads and are known as walks. So now let's understand the execution model. So GPU essentially takes the kernel and the set of warps and executes the instructions in the kernel for each warp. An important point to note here is that the unit of execution is warp and not thread, and all threads within a warp execute in lockstep. So they are like a vector unit that executes in lockstep. Further, all the global variables, they reside in global memory. Now, global memory is an off-chip memory, and hence it has a high latency, and any fetch to this memory takes a long time. But then to compensate for that, global memory allows a high bandwidth access, and about 128 bytes of memory can be accessed in one transaction to the global memory. So this is the execution model. And now let's look at an example of how the programming model works, and then we look at uncoalesced accesses and how what is the problem of uncoalesced accesses. So this is the example that I showed earlier. Let's see how a warp executes this particular kernel. So we have thread IDs ranging from 0 to 31 in this warp, and let's say n is initialized to a value 32 in all of the threads. Now, when the first statement is executed by the warp, x gets values 0 to 31 in each of these threads. Now, the first iteration of while loop is executed, and y gets a value 0, and then z is computed. And now, in the next instruction, two global array accesses are happening. One is to psum, and the another one is to the global array A. So let's first look at how the access to psum executes. So here is what is happening. So because psum is indexed by x, and x takes values from 0 to 31, the access pattern is shown below. And essentially, each thread, consecutive thread, accesses consecutive elements. Now, as I described earlier, global memory allows high bandwidth access, and therefore, all these elements can be fetched in a single transaction. And therefore, we need one global memory transaction to fetch all these elements. Now, when the access to A occurs, there is a problem. And let's try to understand what that problem is. So as you see, A is indexed by Z, and Z takes values that are distant from each other. Therefore, the locations that are accessed in A are spread apart in the memory. And to access all these elements, we need multiple transactions to global memory, because in one transaction, only contiguous memory elements are brought in. And so we need to like access the memory multiple times to get all these elements. And so such a global memory access is known as uncoalesced access. It causes significant performance issues and is one of the primary reasons why GPUs don't perform well, GPU programs don't perform well. Further, it is possible to fix this issue here. So if you look at the original program carefully, what it is doing is it is computing the sum of all the elements in array A. Actually, it's a matrix. It's a flattened matrix. And they are computing the sum of all the cells in array A. The way it does it is that first each thread computes partial sum along the row, and then the partial sums are added together to get the final sum. Now, instead of computing the partial sums along row, if the threads compute the partial sums along the column, which is happening in this write program, then the problem goes away, and the same result is computed. So it is possible to fix these bugs, and they are very important for performance. And so it is important to consider these bugs and also identify them automatically. So this is what GPUDrano does. It is a static analysis to identify uncoalesced accesses. Now, as we saw in the previous part of the talk, uncoalesced accesses is a property of the execution of the board, and hence it happens at the runtime. But it is possible to detect these accesses at compile time or statically, because index variables exhibit regular patterns, and often we don't need concrete values to know whether an access is coalesced or uncoalesced. So let's see what the idea is. So the essential idea is that for each global array access, we essentially need to know what is the dependence of the index variable on thread ID. In particular, we are concerned about the following kinds of dependencies. So the first dependency is where the index variable is constant and does not depend on thread ID. In this case, all the threads get the same value for Z. And essentially, if an access using Z happens, then the same location in the array will be accessed. Next, if Z is of the form TID plus constant, or it is of the form minus TID plus constant, then it represents consecutive locations in the array A. And again, as we saw in our example, these elements can be accessed in a single global memory transaction. Therefore, any access involving these three kinds of index variables will always be coalesced and will work efficiently. Now, if the index variable is not of one of these forms, then we probably have an uncoalesced access. And so we basically have this third, this fourth component, which is Z has an arbitrary dependence on thread ID. And such an access could be potentially uncoalesced. So this is the high level idea, which is we want to essentially compute the dependence of index variables on thread ID. And to do this, we define an abstraction in our analysis, which is we basically track four kinds of values for each of the variable. So whether the variable is a constant, whether it has a unit dependence on thread ID, or whether it has an arbitrary dependence on thread ID, given by this last symbol top. So this is the abstraction. And let's see how the static analysis works now. So what we do is we assign abstract semantics to our programs corresponding to the abstraction. We initialize the variables in a function with an abstract value 0. we execute the program using abstract semantics to compute the abstract values for all of the variables and essentially their dependence on thread ID. And then any accesses that involve an index top, with an abstract value top, we label them as uncoalesced. Now let's look at this with an example. I mean, our previous example that we saw earlier. So initially what would happen is that n would be assigned a value 0 because it is constant across threads. Next, when the first statement is executed, since x has a unit dependence on thread ID, x would be assigned a value 1. Now when the first iteration of while loop is executed, y would be first assigned 0. And now let's see how z is computed, how the abstract value for z is computed. So the expression for z is essentially 0 times 1 plus 0. Now 0 times 1 in traditional multiplication is 0, but this is a multiplication over abstract values. So now if you look carefully, it's essentially a multiplication of a constant with a value that has unit dependence on thread ID, right? So if we multiply these two values, we will probably get a non-constant dependence on thread ID, and therefore we should assign this a value top, okay? And therefore, this multiplication gets a value top, and addition of 0 again leaves it unchanged, and so z gets a value top. And now when we execute the next statement in our analysis, we label A of z as uncoalesced because z has a value top. We leave P sum as it is because the corresponding index is not top. Okay, so this is how the analysis works. There is a small extension to the analysis, which is the idea that what if an access is executed by a single thread? So for example, it happens here. So as you can see, this access to A is potentially uncoalesced because of the similar analysis that we saw earlier. However, the access to this statement, so the access is only executed for one thread over here, since it is within a conditional, and the conditional is true for only one thread in the set of threads that we have. So such an access will always complete in one global memory transaction, and so this should not be labeled as uncoalesced. So to track such kinds of scenarios, we further have an abstraction of Boolean predicates. In particular, we track the dependence of Boolean predicates on thread ID. We track four kinds of values. One is whether it is independent of thread ID. Second, if it is true for only one thread ID, if it is false for at most one thread ID, and then otherwise. So this is the analysis in a nutshell, and now let's see how the analysis performs. So we have implemented Drano in GPUCC, which is an open source LLVM-based CUDA compiler. We compare it against a dynamic analysis implementation, and we evaluate it on a popular benchmark suite of GPU programs called Rodinia. So to understand the comparison better, let's first understand what the dynamic analysis implementation does. So the dynamic analysis implementation essentially executes the program for a specific input and records the number of transactions that are required for each global memory access. And then it reports the average number of transactions that are required per access. So the reason we have an average here is because a static access might be executed multiple times because it's probably within a loop. So we basically take average of all such dynamic instances of a particular static access and report the average. Now, some interesting properties of the dynamic analysis are that first, it gives precise results because it is based on an actual execution. So if we see an uncoalesced access, we know that it is actually an uncoalesced access. And second, it identifies bugs only along the executed path and misses any bugs that lie along the unexecuted branches or uncalled kernels. So now let's look at the results of the comparison. So we basically identify 143 actual bugs in the suite. So the way we do this is we basically collect all the accesses that were done by, that were reported by the dynamic analysis and the static analysis, and then we manually went through them and then validated the potential bugs. I mean, we manually validated the accesses that were uncoalesced. Now, static analysis identifies 111 of these bugs, and it reports 69 false positives. So it does miss some bugs, which is because of some alignment issues. We have discussed this in a paper, but for the simplicity, I don't discuss it here. And further, like, I mean, like any static analysis, our analysis is also conservative, and so we have false positives. I'll discuss some examples why we have false positives in a moment. And finally, dynamic analysis identifies only 69 of these bugs. So this is the like the broad results in terms of how many bugs are identified. Let's look at why Drano reports false positives. So some of the primary reasons why we have false positives. So so this is one example where this is from a benchmark hot wall, where the actual access in the program is coalesced, or it is not uncoalesced, essentially. So the reason is that TID is split into two variables, row and column, and then it is merged back to get the same value in P. So now, if you see P, it corresponds to consecutive locations in consecutive accesses, consecutive threads, and therefore this access is coalesced. However, we don't track the fact that this that TID is being multiplied and divided by the same constant, and therefore we report this as uncoalesced. Similarly, we have imprecision in tracking arrays, and again because of that we report false positives. So due to time, I'm not discussing this here, but yeah, so this is one of the false positives. And then so finally, GPUDrano performs really well. It executes in less than 1 second for most programs, and scales to thousands of lines of code. In comparison, dynamic analysis takes about hundreds of seconds for most of the programs. So GPUDrano is generally fast, and even though it has some false positives, it finishes fast. So now I would like to conclude. And so in this talk, essentially, I showed a tool to identify uncoalesced accesses. This is a first step in this direction of building programming tools for GPU programs. There is a strong need of programming tools for GPU programs, and there's a significant opportunity for this community to contribute in this space. With that, I would like to thank you, and I'm open to questions.
While the next speaker is setting up, so we have time for one, maybe two questions.
Hello. I noticed that your abstract transformers are quite rough. In particular, they don't really distinguish the different operators you can have, which seems to be the root cause for the false positives you talked about briefly. Do you think that making the abstract transformers a little more precise, or actually much more precise by using a polyhedral analysis, would help?
Definitely, there's scope to improve the abstraction, but then it would come at the cost of runtime. I mean, I'm not sure how much runtime that would take. The benefit of this approach is that it finishes in less than, like, I mean, a few seconds for thousands of lines of code, and it's very practical. It's very applicable in practice.
So you don't plan to at least try this? I mean,
I showed you two examples, right? And I think like those two examples were the primary reasons we were getting false positives. So we definitely want to work on that.
Okay, thanks.
I think so. So we would take all the further questions offline and thank the speaker again.
Thank you.